Vladimir Horowitz, considered by many the greatest pianist in the world, will be heard in concert in Moscow tomorrow. It's the first time he's played in his native land in 61 years, a place he once said he would never play again. It's all part of the cultural exchange worked out at the Geneva summit, a journey that has already demonstrated one thing for sure, and that is moving a grand piano from New York to Moscow is every bit as difficult as you might expect. Charles Kuralt reports.
Just pack it with paper inside.
Uh-huh. How'd you like to have the job of Franz Mohr?
There we are.
The job is to ship from New York to Moscow the particular Steinway concert grand that the greatest pianist in the world considers to be the greatest piano in the world, the only piano Vladimir Horowitz will play in public.
That's fine. Here we are.
How do you do that?
Come on.
Well, you get some strong guys and ask them to be careful.
All right, coming over to you. One, two, three, hit it.
A little bit. That's good.
You take the piano apart and put it in a box and put the box in a truck and take it to the airport.
You see where you are, Joe?
Yeah, I'm trying to line it up so that you can go in the slot.
No, you can't go over, Joe. You got to pull this out. Up to the piano. And I'll bring it over.
At the other end of the trip, you get some strong Russian guys and ask them to be careful. You take the piano out of the box and put it together.
Good. And he has the sticks.
And then, if you are Franz Mohr, who knows more about the care and feeding of this piano than any other man alive, you tune it as you have tuned it 1,000 times before. If you are Franz Mohr, chief concert technician of Steinway & Sons, you have a perfect ear, and you tune this piano perfectly. It takes an hour, or two, or three. And then you move the piano to the stage of the Great Hall of the Moscow Conservatory, and you tune it again. How many times do you suppose you've done this? Tuned this particular piano?
Oh, I don't know. I wish I would have a dollar for each tune. I would be a millionaire.
What is it about this piano? What does he like about this particular instrument?
It's a matter of preference or a matter of taste, really, you know. He likes a good quality tone. And it has a little bit of a nasalness, you know. There's a nasal in the sound of it, which he likes, you know. There's a little bit of no. After so many years, you know exactly what he wants and what you can do, right? And if he is happy, I am happy.
And now, as Vladimir Horowitz rehearses before an audience of Soviet music students and professors for his historic concert tomorrow, if you are Franz Mohr, you watch and listen to the great maestro seated at your piano, the piano you have crated and uncrated and assembled and disassembled and coddled and protected and tuned for 20 years, the piano Horowitz thinks is his. And at last, there comes the moment, if you are Franz Mohr, when you think, well, it was all worth it again. Charles Kuralt, CBS News, Moscow.
And a reminder, you can see and hear the Horowitz concert tomorrow morning as Charles Kuralt hosts a special two-hour edition of the CBS News broadcast Sunday morning from Moscow. It starts at 9 a.m. Eastern Time. That's our report. Bob Schieffer, CBS News, New York. Good night.
CBS News Sunday Morning presents renowned pianist Vladimir Horowitz in concert direct from Russia. Join host Charles Kuralt with Horowitz in Moscow tomorrow morning.
Cynics say last year's summit didn't accomplish much, but what about this? Vladimir Horowitz in concert today in his homeland for the first time in over 60 years, a result in part of last year's cultural accords. A full report on Horowitz's dazzling concert a bit later on. Some 60 years ago, a young pianist named Vladimir Horowitz left his native Russia. A few days ago, he returned for an emotional concert today that left his audience in rapture. Horowitz was mobbed from the moment he set foot back in Mother Russia, a slight figure in a long overcoat, a giant in the eyes of his countrymen.
Brilliant pianist and...
Hearing that brilliance clearly was the dream of everyone in Moscow. With only 400 or so seats allotted to the general public, fans waited in line literally for days. And today, they forgot that long wait completely. Horowitz is an intense and high-strung man. In his long career, he has avoided the concert stage for years at a time. Too distracting, he said. So what did he expect in Moscow? He talked with Charles Kuralt.
That is going to be some moment when your relatives...
I will not be able to play piano. I will be so emotional to see them all.
When you put foot on the stage, what will you feel at that moment? I will be shaking, probably.
I don't shake, never. Exactly. I'm concentrated. My concentration is in music. That's all.
Bravo. That's our news this Sunday. I'm Susan Spencer, CBS News, New York. Have a good week.
In a moment, Vladimir Horowitz's triumph in Moscow. In the history of U.S.-Soviet cultural exchanges, it is usually a case of one country sending the other one of its homegrown best. The Bolshoi Ballet comes here, the Boston Pops goes there. But today, a U.S. pianist came home to Russia. Vladimir Horowitz, Ukrainian-born, returned to the homeland he left in 1925. And as Walter Rogers reports, Horowitz's homecoming was a triumph.
Vladimir Horowitz. Horowitz's return to the Moscow stage was musical history. He left Russia 61 years ago in self-imposed exile. The Soviet police had thrown his piano into the street. But today, Horowitz returned, and the Soviet elite adored him. This concert in Moscow and the one in Leningrad are part of the new U.S.-Soviet cultural exchange. At 81, many consider Horowitz the greatest living pianist, and his Soviet tour caps a brilliant career.
Before I die, I want to see the concert where I am born. I cannot wait anymore. And maybe next year I will not play anymore. I don't know.
So lyrical were his interpretations, it seemed the artist, his piano, and the music became one. Many Russian classical music fans called it the greatest experience of their lives. Some literally fought to get in, and afterwards their reviews proved they were not disappointed.
Many years we were waiting, but now we're very happy to listen to him here with such a marvelous, unbelievable playing.
It's generous, it's fantastic.
The Soviets did virtually nothing to publicize this concert, but outside, Russians were offering close to half a month's salary for a ticket. In fact, it was harder to get a ticket for Horowitz in Moscow than a ticket for a Bruce Springsteen concert in America. Walter Rogers, ABC News, Moscow.
That's our report.
To return. Well, he did return, and he made magic. The Soviets loved him. They stormed the doors to get in. The dress rehearsal was packed. It became a performance itself. And ABC News Moscow bureau chief Walt Rogers was there.
Vladimir Horowitz has been striving for musical perfection most of his 81 years. Here in Moscow, a committee is consulted because the floor of the concert stage was not level. A Steinway piano vice president is on hand, and the tuner, the piano's ever-present nanny, hover over Horowitz. Something still is not right. Horowitz is displeased. He mocks photographers who were invited to this rehearsal. Then the great master beckons toward the audience for his wife, Wanda. They brought this piano all the way from their New York apartment.
One foot back.
Mrs. Horowitz is obeyed. She is the daughter of Arturo Toscanini, the great maestro. From every corner of the stage, help arrives. The committee hoists the piano, and a wooden block is inserted under a leg to level the keyboard. Raved about Horowitz's return to the land of his birth. They called him a frenzied genius, praising his willful style and adoring what one writer called, quote, the fairy tale lightness of his airy passages. Horowitz is cited here as the best living example of the Russian tradition of piano playing. It's almost as if he had not forsaken his Russian motherland 61 years ago and gone to America. Horowitz remains a whimsical genius. He stayed here at the American ambassador's residence in Moscow, partially to accommodate his diet. He eats no meat. Fresh fish was flown in. Horowitz does not drink, smoke, nor take pills. Horowitz himself disdains politics. He came to Russia this time to have fun. His sense of fun was contagious. Horowitz is the consummate ham, applauding his entrance to his news conference. He interrupts to make faces or wave to relatives. Microphones bring out the naughty schoolboy in Horowitz, who recounts with mischief the time when, as a child prodigy, he played for the great Russian composer Alexander Scriabin.
And my uncle told me I have a nephew who is so talented, you have to hear him. So I come here, he was singing like that. He was crazy, you know. And one day I played the text 10 minutes and after that he told my mother that, I told you that he will be a pianist and very well, but you have to educate him. I play piano because I saw my mother playing piano and I want to play like her.
Now, aspiring young Soviet pianists play for Horowitz. Perhaps the highest honor the Soviets conferred on Horowitz was letting him play this piano. It belonged to Peter Ilyich Tchaikovsky. Tchaikovsky's grandniece listened as Horowitz played Rachmaninoff on the same piano Tchaikovsky used to compose the Sixth Symphony, the Pathetique, in this room. Tchaikovsky's parlor or a grand concert hall, Horowitz makes it seem at times as if the artist, his piano, and the music become one.
What a performance.
Bravo.
Yeah, it is something.
Think how he must have felt, Hugh, going back there. He left there in 1925, just 7 years after the Russian Revolution, and he would have been 20.
About 20, yeah.
What a world of change, yeah, to go I'll back. Say.
Also, he's an inspiration to watch, not only artistically, but to me it's inspiring to see age in its full potential. You know, a reaction time of a 22-year-old and fingers free of arthritis, and it shows what age can be.
And as you pointed out to me when we were watching, when he was playing, at one point he was playing from the score, no glasses.
Yeah, no glasses, you know, watching the thing. Marvelous man. Oh, that was great to see.
Oh, thrilling.